Welcome to First United Methodist Church, Midlothian. I'm April Fehler, one of the pastors here, and today is Palm Sunday. I know, it's the beginning of the Holy Week, and it's a day of celebration for the Christian church as we welcome Jesus as he arrives with a king's welcome into Jerusalem. So know this, later this week we will be offering services for Monday, Thursday at 7 o'clock, Good Friday at 7 o'clock, and Easter Sunday both at 8:30 and 11 a.m. So I look forward to being able to share that with you. I would also like to let you know that if you are new to this church, we ask that you fill out a guest registration form by scanning the QR code. There it is, if you're here. So if you're online, the link will be in the comments section. Please let us know how to reach you. We would love to be able to connect with you if you are new to this church. That would be great. So one of the things that I would like to let you know is that this is the first Sunday that godly play is returning for us. And this is the way that our children get to spend specific time worshiping God. And so I'm so excited that we have this opportunity. And after all that we've done in this church to try to start bringing things back in after COVID, this is the chance that the children have to be able to begin worshiping in a very, very considerate, very intentional way with Keeley. And so after that first song, you're going to hear from Jason. And then the kids are going to go find Miss Keeley. She is over right over there. And she's going to take them across the way so they can be part of a very powerful worship experience called Godly Play. So let's just make sure you understand that after that first song, that's where they're going to be going. So if you're joining us for the very first time this morning, we ask that you welcome each other in the comments section. If you have any questions or prayer requests, let us know. And now as all of us sit here together, I'd like just, no matter how you've arrived here, whether it is that you've had a long week, whether it is that you are still very busy and just can't sit still, whether you're worried about something or you're scared about something, I ask that you lay all that aside and focus in on this very moment of worship. Because at this moment, if you are in focus, if you're in a place where you can breathe, then you can be here and expect to experience the presence of God in the midst of this worship. So with that, let us begin.
Church, would you stand and let's sing worship. God, we lift you up in praise. Sing this dry and desert land.
This dry and desert land, I tell myself keep walking on. Here's something up ahead, water falling like a song. An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. Soul, a flood for my soul. Oh, well, then your voices. Come on, church. Open the heavens. Come, living water. All my fountains are in you. Oh, you're strong.
Church, as we continue in our worship, we're going to pray over our little ones as they head over to Godly Play. So if you guys start making your way over there, you're going to meet Miss Keeley right over there at the front. There you are. Head on over there to her, and let's pray. And parents, feel free to walk your kids over there. That's totally fine. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you so much. Lord, thank you for our children as they are being raised up in such a beautiful, beautiful fellowship. Thank you, Lord, that they can meet with you, talk to you, Lord, have their own space to be able to work out their faith and to be able to meet with you in such a beautiful, intimate place. So thank you, Jesus, for vision that was cast. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence of being with them. So we pray over that, and as we continue in our worship, Jesus, would you be satisfied? Would you be filled with our praise? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, we know that all these things that we carry, all these burdens, they cannot stand up when we're in the Father's house. Amen? And when we come to His house, He has ultimate authority. And so we are called to bring everything, everything. There's not a thing in our life that we're called to leave out. We're called to bring everything to Him. Everything under His jurisdiction. So we're going to sing a song called The Father's House. It's a beautiful, beautiful song. So if you've ever heard it before, sing loud. If you've never heard it before, let it wash over you in worship. Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your soul. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. Well, failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. Yeah, failure won't define me. That's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door. Sit and welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Yeah. Lift it up. Arrival's not the end game. Arrival's not the end game. The journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect. You just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over if the story isn't good. Failure's never final when the Father's in. Oh, lift that up, church. If failure's never final when the Father's in the room, ooh, lay your burdens down, ooh, here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door, sit and welcome anymore, ooh, you're in the Father's house, yeah. sing about the miracles that happen when He's in charge.
Prodigals come home, the helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors swing wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
Oh, lift it up.
Miracles take place, the cynical find faith, and love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Jericho walls are quaking, strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room.
Come on.
Yeah, love is breaking through. Lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door. Is it ain't welcome anymore? Ooh, 'cause you're in the Father's house.
Somebody say amen. Come on, yeah, we are. We are free, church. Free, yes, we are. Let us live in that. Let us live in that. I sing it out. I see the King of Glory.
I see the King of Glory. People.
lift those palm branches high. Sing Hosanna.
Hosanna. Hosanna.
As he rides on a colt. So Jesus, would you take what we have, our metaphorical cloaks that we lay down before you, our palm branches that we lay down before you in preparation, Jesus. You are our victorious King. Take this worship, and Father, would you do something great with it? Jesus, we believe in your miracles. We believe you are not limited by our same limitations, but you are free to do as you desire. So Jesus, come on and do such things. The things that only you can do. The breaking of chains and the tearing down of walls. Oh, set us free, Lord. Good and pure and faithful worship. That is our desire, to give you what you deserve. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Yes, God, we remember the prayer that you taught us to pray long ago. So with gratefulness in our heart, worship and glory in our voice, we say it this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Trespasses. Oh, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
Scripture this morning comes from Luke 19, 28 through 45, and it reads, after Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem, and he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives. He sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it? Say, the Lord needs it. Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked him, why are you untying the colt? They replied, The Lord needs it. They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. And as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down to Mount Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." And as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They'll dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another, because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. My best friend Robin from high school went with me to pack up my things from my childhood home to move into the dorms at the University of Texas at Dallas, at Arlington, excuse me. It was a dream come true for me. I packed up all my records, all my cassette tapes, a few 8-track tapes, two. My concert t-shirts, a few of my ripped up jeans with those little safety pins. Remember those big ones? I got my typewriter prepared for my new life on my own. As Robin got in the front seat with me, I hesitated for a moment. I had to choke back some tears as I looked through the rear view mirror. My parents had just stepped back inside the house. I was remembering the little things, you know, the ones that you don't really think about at the time, but as you drive away, they mean the world to you. She and I talked about the good old days, all of them, good, bad, and ugly, from the high school moments all the way to Arlington, Texas. See, for us, crossing the Arlington city limits was like crossing a threshold in our lives. It's a place where our times had changed for us. I went from my parents and cross the city limits into a new college life. And I would be connected to that school throughout graduate school. Just a few weeks later, after helping me move, Robin would leave her father's house and catch a plane so that she could join the Army just before the Gulf War started. Stepping over into these times and places, these thresholds, it means you've decided to make a change and move forward with that change in mind. The Bible is full of these threshold moments. In Luke 4:38, Jesus was literally standing the threshold of Peter's mother-in-law's house. He had just healed the woman because she was sick. And as he was looking out her front door, he notices there's a huge crowd of people in need of healing and saving and exorcisms. And as they came towards him, he knew that if he stepped over that doorway and outside, then he would have to embrace a huge crowd after crowd public ministry. And so he stepped over that threshold, and a private ministry changed into a very public ministry. And he began serving the many instead of just a collective. selection of a few. In Mark 5:21, we see a bleeding woman ventures away from the shadows where she's lived for 12 years, crawling among the feet of an excited crowd just to reach towards Jesus' cloak for healing. Her threshold moment was when she left the hideout where she was safe, because she knew if they had ever seen her outside that hideout, she could be killed instantly. Because with the touch of her hand, she can make you unclean. If you're unclean, you could be ousted from the community too. She knew she could have been killed for being out in the open. So her threshold was actually going outside of that hiding space. And none of us can forget Judas and his threshold, right? In Luke 22:46, in a single kiss, he moved beyond beloved disciple and friend over the threshold to the ultimate betrayer. He betrayed his close friend over 30 pieces of silver. And there's no way back from threshold moments like that. I was forever changed by going to college. My best friend, Robin, was forever changed by being in the army, especially during wartime. So we enter our scripture this morning with Jesus parked on the side of the road, waiting for his disciples to bring him a young donkey to ride to the city. He was preparing to enter in to the city of peace, just as the kings had done before him. And he was about to make a statement about who he was and who he was there to serve. And by doing so, he would step over that threshold of the city limits in ways he can't take back. So Jesus was the king of the oppressed. He was the king of the suffering. The king whose subjects were fishermen, tax collectors. And all of those like Samaritans and harlots, blind men, lepers. He was going to Jerusalem, the city of peace, to lead the charge of bringing peace and love to a town that has seen its share of trouble over time. And for those of you that know your biblical history, you know that the temple in Jerusalem is about to be destroyed about 35 years after Jesus' crucifixion. Jesus knew it. So he really wanted to fight to do what he could to save Jerusalem. The last chance he has to appeal to the people there. So Jesus follows the same ritual that other kings do when they parade themselves through a city. He rides in on a donkey, though, not on a horse that a king or a great warrior would be on, to represent humility. The cloaks that his disciples have laid down on top of this donkey for comfort, and on the ground in front of the donkey to honor him, to walk on, were all worn and tattered, represented the poor and the working people without means that he was serving. Though it's not listed in Luke's gospel specifically, the other gospel writers describe a scramble to get the disciples shouting out blessings to go find ways that they can find palm branches, and with those palm branches they can celebrate that peace is coming. They can celebrate the king that was coming in. They can celebrate the change, the possibilities, the hope, the peace that was coming their way. They can celebrate the blessings of the king's arrival. But up until this point, Jesus still has not met the threshold yet. All of this has happened before he even crosses into the city limits of Jerusalem. And I can only imagine the threshold moment that's coming. Jesus can clearly see the gates of Jerusalem ahead of him when he sees the Pharisees out of the corner of his eyes come up to him, because the Pharisees have heard what his disciples are saying out loud about him. Behold, there is a king, the Prince of Peace. Check him out. He's coming in. This king. Pharisees approach him and say, look, you need to rebuke your disciples. You need to rebuke your disciples for celebrating a king that does not exist. And all he could do was stare at Jerusalem right in front of him and weep. Knowing that he had done all that he could to bring peace to a city who could not recognize what he was bringing to the table. The good news of hope and love and grace was lost on Jerusalem right now. But see, what makes Jesus a true king, what makes Jesus a true savior, is the difference between him and other kings. Is that when met with a threat, since Jesus has known all this time that he was going to die and be crucified, that Jerusalem was the end of the line for him. If the kings knew that they were facing death in Jerusalem, they would have fought for their lives with their horses and their weapons, because that's what the people expected from them, and that's what they know how to do. But Jesus is a different kind of king. Who was more interested in bringing peace into a world that needed it than to add additional violence into it. A different kind of king is the one who will save us. Even though he knew there is where his life will end, he still chose to cross that threshold for us. And ironically, he would step into these walls wanting no more than just the peace for the people. But he would leave in restraints as a prisoner. So in the midst of the celebration, the midst of the excitement that Palm Sunday brings, let us not forget the generosity and the grace of our Lord on this day. Because no other worldly king or warrior would have done the same as Jesus did for us on that day. And you know, in Holy Week, it's only just begun. But Jesus has chosen us from the very beginning, has done everything in his humanly power to convince us that there is still hope and that things can change in a matter of seconds. The beautiful part, when you think about Palm Sunday and the beginning of this Holy Week, we realize that Jesus did everything he could to be the king he knew we needed. It's a time when we are intentional about celebrating the arrival of this much-needed king who brought the promise of peace into this world that still struggles with what to do with it. It's a time where the community celebrate their kings by waving palm branches in the air as he entered Jerusalem. And as we continue into this week, for those of you who have your palm leaves, who've received these palm leaves as they've walked in, I would invite you to take these palm leaves with you in whatever way that you can. Keep them with you at the moments that you read your waypoints over this next week. And while reading these waypoints, I want you to remember how much Jesus did to bring us peace at his detriment. How much Jesus did to provide us a brand new way of life over and over and over and over again. Just so that every time you read a waypoint that celebrates what's going to happen through Holy Week during this week, that you can be in a place of recognizing what kind of a generous an amazing Savior that we have. I ask that you all be intentional about remembering this bringer of peace, the one who chose us as he approached that threshold, the one who crossed it out of love for us, knowing we weren't ready to receive it or appreciate it. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, today we celebrate you as a different kind of king. We are shaped by the world we live in to love people that look like us, to love people who think like us, to love people who believe like us. And sometimes, Lord, the ones that look like us, think like us, and believe like us don't always look, think, or believe like you. Forgive us for being like Jerusalem, for not seeing the ways of peace through you. Show us the way to serve you from the inside out, to seek that peace with and for others. In your name, guide us, Lord Jesus, so that one day we may begin to look like you, think like you, and believe like you. Remind us this week of the meaning of the palm branches, and may the symbolism of peace and victory over death hold a place in our hearts, in our minds, so that we may appreciate others and share this victory and peace with them openly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand as we continue our worship. Can we lay everything down before him? Above all names, sing out your name. Shout your name, oh Lord.
have a few announcements before I move through the benediction. And so, know this. To make sure that you know what's going on Holy Week, I just want to remind you that we've got the services Monday, Thursday. It's on this coming Thursday at 7 o'clock in the sanctuary. We've got Good Friday. And Good Friday will start at 7 o'clock also in the sanctuary. We will have 8:30 service and 11 o'clock service on Easter. For those of you who would like to attend the 8:30 service, just know that the 8:30 service, once it begins to fill up, there will be we will be streaming the service in the Family Life Center. If we have finally met a capacity, all that can be inside the sanctuary, we will also be streaming the service in here. So if you wanted to attend the sanctuary service at 8:30, get here early. Also wanted to say that we've got, this church is so incredibly generous in so many different ways. And I think it's amazing what can be done if your heart is in missions and you're looking for ways to serve this community. And I know on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday of this week, Cheryl Whedon and a group of people from this church are going to be feeding our first responders. Where's Cheryl? So Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, this is going to happen. So we got firemen, policemen. Am I missing anybody? So we're going to be feeding them where they serve. Correct? And so I know you've got a team of people that are going to be helping you do this, and I'm excited to hear this. And so one of the things that I want you to know, it's because of your generosity that this happens. And we have another code for giving, another QR code for giving. So just know that all of the things that you are able to provide for us goes for us to be able to do these types of things in our community. So I would encourage you to continue to give in this way, because it allows us to show appreciation for the people that serve us best. So also note, that in this Holy Week, things have only just begun. But remember that we are the blessed, that we are the sacred, that we are the chosen, because we have a God that loved us so much he would send his son here. And that son loved us so much that he would be willing to travel all the way to Jerusalem to show us a way to peace, to have that peace. So I would ask you, while you read your waypoint devotionals, remember the peace that Jesus tried to give us is the same peace that you can carry today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.